Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Glad to see all these smiling faces out in the crowd. Appreciate everybody being here today. At this time, Clerk Barger, I'd like to call this meeting to order.
Master Combs?
Here.
Master Barger?
Here.
Master Tudor?
Here.
Master Bodkin?
Present.
Judge Taylor?
Here. At this time, Pastor Jared Latham from North Ridge Church is going to come up and lead us in a word of prayer. Appreciate you being here today.
Thank you, everybody. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful morning. We thank you for the men who serve on this court. We thank you for the department heads in this county, Lord. Lord, today I pray a special blessing upon each one. As they gather to do the business of this county, I ask you would give them wisdom, give them discernment. Lord, I ask they would be good stewards with the money that they're working with, and that they would think of the least of these in their decision making. Lord, just bless this time. Let it be a good time. Let it be an enjoyable time. Lord, just ask that all things that are decided in this room will glorify you. To your Son's holy and precious name I pray. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Thank you.
At this time, Sheriff, if you will.
Please. Would you stand, place the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Be seated.
Vice Chair. Guys, y'all had a chance to look over your minutes from the previous meeting. This time I need a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second. Call the roll, please.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barger?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bodkin?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Glenna, this time you're going to give us your treasurer's report.
In your drop box, you'll find the financial report as of 4/30/2016. Our balance of total funds on 4/30/2016 was $7,300,660.08. Our general fund as of 4/30 is at 90% on its revenues and 59% on expenditures. Our road fund is at 79% on revenues and 69% on expenditures. Our jail fund is at 95% revenues and 79% on expenditures. Our CSEP fund is at 33% revenues and 30% expenditures. And our 911 fund is at 92% revenues and 50% expenditures. So all of our expenditures are definitely under, so we're doing good.
What did you say the jail was? I didn't catch it.
I'm sorry?
The jail.
The jail is at 95% on its revenues and 79% on its expenditures. Okay.
Glenda, does that include
That's as of 4/30.
Does that include the, we're getting ready to budget amend in?
No, that does not include that.
That does not include that?
No.
Okay.
So you may have any questions?
You don't have any. Y'all have anything?
But what we're going to put in is earmarked, right? It's already budgeted?
The budget amendment that we're getting ready to do, those are going into reserve for transfer, which can be transferred to any line item that we need to finish out the year.
Yeah, the reserve for transfer was extra funds we got in from the jail fund, which we haven't made it there yet, which doesn't have anything in our budget.
That was what I was getting at. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So if you'll just hang tight right there real quick. I'd like to ask the court's permission to amend the agenda today. We have two different personnel hires that have come up. One's in Battlefield Golf Course and one is in Solid Waste. So I'd like to amend the agenda to add those to today's agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Call the roll, please.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bodkin?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barger?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. All right, so next on the agenda is the first reading of Ordinance 1609, which is a budget amendment to the jail fund. These are actually additional revenues that we have got in this year on the jail. And in your all's drop box in your packet, you will see the total amount is $104,546. So if you want to explain any of this, Glenna, to the court, feel free.
Anytime we get in more money than we budgeted, and we always try to budget conservatively on our revenues, So a lot of times we do go over because we do budget conservatively. In our state prisoner line item, we are expected to have $57,000 extra, more than what we budgeted for. Our jail telephone commissions have come in really good. We have approximately $18,000 more. And surplus from prior year. At the end of each year, you have to have a guesstimate of what is going to be sitting in your checking balance on June 30th. So it's not always exact. So we were $29,000 over what we had expected. So we can also budget amend that in for a total of $104,546. That goes into the jail reserve for transfer. Then if we need it to finish out the year in state prisoners, the transport or food or whatever we need it in, we can transfer it out of there.
Housing inmates stuff.
Housing, whatever.
Jasmine.
I think it's a good thing anytime you have more money coming in than what you expected. And so $104,000 would go a long way to funding up some of those jail expenses. So I think it's a good thing. Really. Appreciate you working on that.
What is jail consultants?
Jail consultants, yeah. In the new budget?
Well, you've got to add, you want to add it to the jail fund?
Yes, in the new budget.
In the new budget, yeah. So I need a motion and a second on first reading of ordinance 1609, which is a budget amendment for the jail fund.
So moved.
Second.
Any more discussion? Call the roll, please.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Berger?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Next is the first reading of ordinance 1608, which is a budget amendment road fund, which is NRCS fund. So this is some extra funds that we're getting through the NRCS for work that we're going to be doing on Crutcher Pike and Doylesville Road. Mm-hmm. Yep. So they ended up having some extra fund.
Yeah, I think, and actually I think this one was for Valley Road and Phelps Road. Is it, this is work that we've already done that they're reimbursing us for. I think we will get more for those two roads you just mentioned.
Okay, I'm sorry. Well, that original project, we did three roads.
Okay, this was for two of them.
So it didn't include Bill Eads. Because I think Bill Eads.
I think it was Bill Eads and Valley.
Uh-huh.
Is that right?
Willie, when we originally did that project, we did Bill Eads, Valley, and Phelps. Is that right?
Valley and Phelps were done first, and then Bill Eads.
Bill Eads, yep.
It's for two of those. I can't remember which one. I'm thinking Valley and Bill Eads.
So this is not our new roads?
No. So we'll be getting more. You have to get all the work done before they're going to give you.
They're going to give us some money. Okay. All right.
So what's the total on these? 26 and 52.
You know, I don't have that.
I'm looking at something else.
Glenn. I was going to say.
Yeah, I'm looking at something else.
It came in one check as 75,555.
Yeah. Okay. And so those are projects that we never obviously didn't know because you didn't know you were going to have a flood and have damage.
Exactly.
And so you have to, yeah. All right. So I need a motion and a second on the first reading of ordinance 1608.
So moved.
Second.
If there's no more discussion, call the roll, please.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Berger?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Thanks, Glenn. Appreciate it. Next is a proclamation of Community Action Month, Kentucky River Foothills. Karen, if you'd like to come up to the podium, I'm gonna read the proclamation, and then if you want to say anything, you're more than welcome to. Okay. Whereas Community Action emerged from America's War on Poverty, Community Action agencies were created as part of the Economic Opportunity Act of 1964 and exist to lead initiatives that provide opportunities for self-sufficiency and success for those who with limited incomes. And whereas Community Action agencies are community-based organizations that bring together all segments of the community to identify goals and priorities. And whereas Kentucky River Foothills Development Council, Inc. is the local community action agency and has been providing a comprehensive range of services for families and individuals for 54 years. Kentucky River Foothills Development Council, Inc. develops community resources so that all persons may have lives of dignity, responsibility, and opportunity. And whereas Kentucky River Foothills Development Council, Inc. dedicates this month to increasing public awareness of their programs and services. And whereas Kentucky River Foothills Development Council, Inc. believes that communities must work together in partnership to enable all persons to live with dignity, responsibility, and opportunity. To support this vision, Kentucky River Foothills Development Council offers a myriad of services that promote stability and independence throughout the life cycle. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Judge Executive Reagan Taylor, do hereby proclaim May 2016 as Community Action Month in Madison County, and urge all citizens to mark this observance by recognizing the important work done by Kentucky River Foothills Development Council.
Thank you. The one thing that I will just interject here is that, you know, it says in the proclamation that we were founded by the Economic Opportunity Act. And so we've been around for a long time. We're the largest human service agency in Madison County. And you might not connect all the dots, but I bet when I throw out a few program names, you will. We provide Head Start, the Senior Citizen Centers, both Berea and Richmond, Liberty Place Recovery Center for Women, the Richmond Child Care Center out on Duncannon Lane. We have a veterans program for homeless or marginally housed, and you know, so many more others. We have about 40 programs. So Judge Taylor actually sits on our board, and we're glad to have him, and thank you for recognizing him this month.
Thank you. If you don't mind, introduce
the chair. Yeah, sure. So I'm Karen. This is Jason Hill. He's our Director of Personnel and Policy. I just want to say HR. And Shelley Howard is our Director of Community Services. So she's actually at the outreach office around the corner, and that's where a lot of people that come to us go to for the first time. That's their first point of contact. Somebody's told them, hey, you need to go see Foothills, so they'll send them to the outreach office. They're hungry, they need energy assistance, whatever. And then if we can't help them, then we'll connect the dots with someone else out in the community and other social service agencies.
Thank you all. Appreciate you being here. Thank you guys, appreciate you being here. Next is first reading ordinance 1605, which is 2016-17 Madison County Fiscal Court Budget. And you all got a sheet of some of the changes from the original draft. I think you all might have some questions. I know, Larry, you asked a question just a minute ago about the jail consultant. So, you know, we've had a jail task force that has been working for 9 months. We have a special call meeting on the 2nd of June, and they're going to come and present their results of the findings and all the information that we've gathered. It'll be in a PowerPoint. We put $50,000 in the budget for taking that next step, which would be hiring a firm that will help us in the design if that's what we so choose to do. Now, that doesn't mean that this would still have to come before court for the approval to actually spend this allocation. But we just wanted to go ahead and put it in the budget in case that's what the court decided to do.
Well, you put it in there, I'm sure we can. But and that's probably in the direction.
We got to do something. I mean, we know that, and so hopefully after the task force presents this to the court, then it'll give us a few days to sleep on it, and maybe make a decision at the next meeting or the following meeting after that.
I'd like to use that $50,000 to build a nice sign that says no vacancy. Well, no, we can't. Double
sack,
coming and going.
I know y'all have had a chance to look over your budget. We did have to make some tough decisions of doing some cutting to make everything work. But it is a work in progress, and we're improving every year. We had a lot of great savings this past year. I'm very proud of our department heads, our employees, and their duty. So Glenda, do you have anything to add that you want to add?
No, I just wanted to be available in case you had any questions.
Our medical contract, Judge, that we're adding money to this year, they were on a two-year contract, and at the end of the first year, obviously, they're renegotiating with us. So I'm just wondering about the same circumstances. Should we find another provider? Are we obligated to opt out of their services at any time?
We are. It's 30. The contract says either party has 30 days to get out, and we have not signed a new agreement yet with them. I think their contract is up maybe in September of this month, so they're 2 years. I think they came in, I believe, at September 14. Their contract expires, but obviously they're wanting to do something before the end of that contract because of the population of our facility and how many people need help, need medical attention. In the month of April, we booked 500, and I think I've told this, but we booked 500 people into our jail. 274 of those had to be on detox. So our medical, what they signed on for is really not what's taking place. And they based it off of their experience. I don't 100% agree with it, but it's the card that we're dealt, and we have to make it the best of it. If we so choose to go in back into agreement with Southern Health Partners, then we have the money in, we'll have the money in the budget to compensate them for their additional charges. And that extra amount is for another person 5 days a week, 8 hours a day, is what that's based off of.
I just thought it was important that folks understand why that they're needing a $50,000 increase after 1 year. And I mean, it's directly related to the drug problem in Madison County. I mean, we just get prisoners in that are in such bad shape.
Every time we send someone out to another jail, are we still obligated for their medical bills when they're in that other jail?
Yes.
Do we get a separate bill on that each month?
I don't know that
we've
had any.
Or they just concluded then?
I don't know that we've had any. Normally, they won't take someone else. I mean, if you've got somebody with medical problems, you're not going to send them to another jail.
And more than likely, too, we're not going to send somebody's that's sick to another facility, but if they so happen to get sick there, I'm sure if it was bad enough, we would probably go back and get them.
Yeah, because they can send them back at any time. They don't have to take them. So if they have a sick one, I'm sure they'll be sending them back.
Well, and not only that, state come in and they downsized some, didn't
they? 20 beds.
20 beds.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't win. I wish somebody in the audience had the answer to this question. I mean, it's a multi question, but I don't know what we did. You know, you beat your head against the wall, it's not going to help.
Glenn, on the contracted inmate housing, the $230,000, is that what it's cost us in the past year to house in other facilities? Is that what the...
Yes, that's what it cost us last year. Mm-hmm. I think it cost us $218,000.
Do you have a number of how many we were housed during the...
Doug would probably have that number of exactly how many.
Okay.
But that's how much it cost us in that year.
Well, you could
this
figure.
Year we actually had like a month or two that we had everybody back in our jail. And so that helped us. But we're still going to be right there.
But we have a bunch out.
We have figured it's costing us $32 and something a day to house it.
It's not quite that much.
No.
It's 20. You could average 28.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what they're telling
you. It depends on the jail. Some charge 27, some charge 29.
Yeah.
But that's a whole lot of out of house.
Yeah, juveniles go to Fayette County, we have to pay that.
That's what happens when the state has a mandate that you are going to do this no matter what it costs you.
And if you look, you know, a lot of people say, well, we shouldn't be housing state inmates. We should just house our own. Well, when you look at how much we bring in, it's over $500,000 is what we're bringing in to house state inmates. And we're on target to hit that this year.
Yeah, we're actually going over 57, so we should be right at 600,000.
So, and so if you're receiving 600 and you're only spending out 230, well, I mean, it's a no-brainer. You know, it's better for us financially to keep housing the state inmates where we get paid for and pay a lesser amount to house ours outside the county.
With this additional $50,000, what will that be for the total year?
$300,000 for the medical?
Yeah.
It'd be $300,000.
It's going up $4,000. I can't remember the exact numbers. It's $4,000 something a month.
Could we not buy a policy for everybody that comes in jail? I mean, it's something to consider.
Yeah. Well, I've thought about.
Or is there any companies out for that?
I've thought about, you know, obviously, could we hire our own nurse?
Well, you know, I asked you about getting some doctor coming down medical school.
Right.
$200,000, pretty good.
And we did that several years ago. We had a private doctor.
Yeah, we did.
But the liability got so outrageous that he couldn't afford the liability of working in a jail.
Well, they put the new county attorney on the spot, but could we assume that liability?
Like everything else, it's certainly something you could look into and make an educated decision on at that time.
Oh, we got a lot of smart people here today. Surely somebody's got an answer for me.
I would say your liability is going to be higher than your cost is. That's the whole reason we went to having a company, is because they take on all the liability.
Well, I guess we can be thankful we got the money to fund it. So that's all we'd be thankful for.
But the audience needs to understand, too, that the state inmates, you can have 50 today, and they want to bring 20 of them out of there tomorrow. We have no call on that.
Right.
So, day to day, you don't know what you're going to get or what you're going to have until they take.
Yeah, and of course, the judge and I, we talk about this all the time. The sheriff's department's not putting that many in. It's the state police, the city of Richmond, the city of Bree, and they pay nothing.
The county pays the bill.
Same with dogs. State law mandates. I'm going to vote.
I need a motion and a second for the approval of the first reading of Ordinance 1605, which is the 2016-17 budget.
So moved.
Second.
If there's no more discussion, call the roll, please.
Mr. Berger?
Yes.
Mr. Tudor?
Yes.
Mr. Bunkin?
Yes.
Mr. Combs?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Thanks, Glenn. Appreciate it. Next on the agenda is a first reading of Ordinance 1606, which is the compressor station that's going to be constructed out between Hackett Pike and Red House Road. And then after we talk about the compressor station, I'm sure this will kind of go in conjunction with each other. We're going to talk about the pipeline as well, which will be the first reading of Ordinance 1607. The Planning Commission has sent a recommendation to the fiscal court to adopt these ordinances on the compressor station and on the pipeline. These would require conditional use permits for these companies to be able, before they could construct a compressor station, they would have to go through our Board of Adjustments. And then also, with it being a new facility like that, they'd have to go through planning and zoning as well because of the site development plan. We have Craig Williams here today to answer any questions that you all might have. I know we had that public meeting last Wednesday. We also had televised it as well. And the Planning Commission asked a lot of questions. Some of y'all were in attendance. So,
Judge Eisen, attendance of that last meeting last Wednesday, and everybody that was attending was very much positive on going forward with these regulations on these compressor and the pipeline repurposing because of the safety issues. I've been involved with this for several months. Last summer and last fall, Mr. Williams and I went over to Boyle County and listened to some of their planning and zoning meetings and their fiscal court, what they were able to come up with about the conditional uses and their regulations, and we've kind of adopted on the same pattern as what they went with. And so I think we're all in accordance with going forward with these regulations because of the safety issues, because of this being a 70-year-old pipeline, and because of the where this line goes through the county. It goes through a lot of neighborhoods. It goes next to schools. It goes across Main Street up here. Just the safety issues and putting the high pressure chemicals in opposite directions. So I think we're all in accordance on this issue. Mr. Williams, you got something you want?
I'm just here.
You want to add to it?
If there's any questions of it.
We have a good crowd.
We did. The courtroom was full.
It was a really good crowd.
The compressors, Mr. Williams, did they address the soundproofing and stuff in that?
Yes, they did.
In there pretty
good. They, at the work session prior to the business session, at which they made the recommendation to you all, there was any number of questions, about a dozen questions that were asked by the Planning Commission about specific issues associated with both ordinances. On the compressor station in particular, noise and aesthetics and proximity to residential areas and waterways were the primary focus, and all of those questions were addressed and are captured in the proposed ordinance that's before you now.
Have you all actually seen one? Have you seen one of them to see what it actually sounds like?
Not on the internet, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. But I've seen the Taj Mahal on the internet too, though.
Yeah. Where's the closest one at?
I think there's one that's already in Garrett County, and then there's one that's north.
It's one in Round, isn't it?
Yeah, Round County. There's one
fairly equal to what they want to build here?
That I don't know. I can tell you that if this ordinance is passed and the conditional uses within the ordinance are met, it will be state-of-the-art, the most modern and most aesthetically pleasing and quiet compressor station in the country. But the requirements are not overly burdensome to where it would be outside the scope of the authority of the Planning Commission, the court, and the Board of Adjustments to enforce. So we're comfortable with saying to these folks, we want you to do what you have to do in order to keep energy flowing, but here's what you got to do to accommodate this county's needs.
Yeah.
And so that's what this is really all about.
I mean, we at the end of the day, we need to protect our community, and we need to protect our property values for those areas, you know.
Is this something they prepared or we actually prepared?
The language that you're looking at was drafted by the Kentucky Resources Council in Frankfort. Tom Fitzgerald, who you may know as Fitz, the predominant environmental attorney in the state, drafted both the Boyle County ordinances and then tailored these to accommodate Madison County's needs, plus the input that the judge and I and others provided to him. Brought it forward. It was modified again at the actual business meeting. There was a couple of modifications. Those have been captured now in the documents before you. And so he's the author of it, but the attorney for the Planning Commission was involved in reviewing and coordinating with Fitz in order to make sure that everything was how it needed to be legally. So that's where we are.
That's Jubal.
Jubal Miller.
Yeah, he looked like he's soaking wet when the meeting was over with.
It was a good meeting, and the diversity of the crowd I thought was great, because you had young people, old people, activists, farmers. You had a real broad spectrum of landowners, subdivision folks, scientists. EKU came out in favor of the ordinances, as did the Madison County School Superintendent. We had the head scientist from the from Battelle Laboratories, who is the chief scientist at the chemical weapons disposal plant, also testified in favor of both of these ordinances. So we had a very broad spectrum and diverse group of folks come up and support it. And as was mentioned, there was nobody that stood up and said, we think we should run these materials through a 70-year-old pipeline, or that we should not care about what the compressor station looks like or sounds like. So it was unanimous in favor of passing these things.
And one of the things too is I want to give a shout out and a thank you to Mr. Larry Hensley. Larry Hensley is a resident out on Red House Road, and he brought this to my attention over a year ago, and really worked with me And John, he's in, obviously, John's district, and really did his civic duty to help us understand the impact of this. Mr. Hensley got ill and hasn't been able to really be as involved here late. But really, he and his wife both had done a lot of research on their own and knew this inside and out. Helped us sending our concerns and passing the resolutions that we passed about a year ago. And so I just want to thank him and his wife for their due diligence and doing their civic duty and helping us understand the impact on this. And we've been in contact with Kendra Morgan. We've sat in meetings with them. We've encouraged them to come and communicate and educate to our community of what they're going to be doing, help us understand, and really haven't gotten anywhere. And so, you know, I feel like it's in our best interest to pass these ordinances and to protect have kind of a rule sheet to follow. We're not saying don't come, all right? We're just saying follow these rules to protect our community. So,
like you said there, Judge, we've been involved for over a year, and Craig and I went over and met with Mr. Fitzgerald over at Boyle County, and actually, we didn't have to do a lot of persuading. We just asked if he would come and kind of present his message to Madison County. And last October, we had a community forum out at the Extension office and had over 150 turnout there for him to just explain the process of this repurposing pipeline and the compressor station and, you know, get people aware of the situation. And after doing all that, I think the community has come together and really been behind this and supported putting some regs on this to make it safe for the community. And I appreciate what Mr. Williams has done, and I appreciate what Tom Fitzgerald did and all his with his attorney being able to write up the regs on it and all of his knowledge that he's shared with us. It's just gone a long way. And I think, actually, I've had Kendra Morgan call me and said, why are you opposed to this pipeline repurposing? I said, because of the safety issues. That's the main concern here. And like the judge said, we sit here at this panel 6 or 8 months with Kendra Morgan and said, you guys need to come and have a community forum and discuss it with the community and explain what's going to take place. And they said, well, we feel like it'd be a hostile environment. We'd rather not do that. So they kind of refused to come and explain to us. So that's where we are. And so we're moving forward with these rigs on this pipeline and compression. I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, I'd just like to chime in and thank the magistrates that did show up. I've seen several of you at different meetings over the years period that we've been focused on this, and so I appreciate you all taking the time to educate yourselves so that you know what we're engaged in. And then if you couple that with community support, like you mentioned, I think we've achieved a lot. And I think, you know, first reading, I'm hoping that everything goes well. We get the second reading, get it passed. And then we have a template upon which to work and how to deal with Kendra Morgan on a formal basis and not just people calling each other and saying, well, we're going to do this, and have no ability to enforce it, have no ability to negotiate what it is exactly and precisely that they're doing. So I think it's a great advantage to the entire community from a safety standpoint.
And it's not just Kendra Morgan. It would be any.
Correct.
Any.
That's right.
I make a motion that we accept Ordinance 16-06 pertaining to the compressor.
I'll second that.
Any more discussion? No more. Call the roll, please.
Magistrate Tudor?
Yes.
Magistrate Bakken?
Yes.
Magistrate Combs?
Yes.
Magistrate Berger?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. And then just to first reading of Ordinance 16-07, which is the pipeline, just to get into a little bit more detail. This runs through 24 miles of our county. And this is them repurposing. They're basically going to abandon an existing pipeline. It's natural gas. And they're going to repurpose it into a natural gas liquids pipeline. They're also going to change the flow of it to run from north to south. Right now it runs from south to north.
With just natural gas.
With just natural gas, yeah. And so this would be basically, again, along the same lines as the compressor station, kind of a rule sheet. Conditional use permit they would have to obtain before they could do any of this in Madison County. So if there's, I need a motion and a second on that. If
I move we adopt ordinance 1607 for the repurposing pipeline for the regulations on that.
Second.
Is there any more discussion? If not, call the roll, please.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Parker?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Next, thanks.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Appreciate it a lot.
Okay.
Next is the Madison County Detention Center, Southern Health Partners contract. We just talked about this just a few minutes ago in somewhat detail when we were talking about the budget. What's y'all's feeling on the contract with Southern Health Partners?
Doug, have you checked with some other jails about what they're doing?
Other jails, well, let me apologize for being late, but it's got a lot of radiation. But other jails have Southern Health Partners, have advanced correctional health care. Fayette County, I don't know who Fayette County's got. I know, but I don't know the name of it. I actually called them and they won't deal with us because we don't have at least 600 inmates or more. But most everybody around the state that has medical either has Larry or Advanced Correctional or Southern Health Partners. That's the majority of what everybody has. Now, the other day we talked, Colleen sent me some over. A couple of them we had no idea how to get a hold of these people. The other two or three that we contacted have not got back with us on anything yet.
Yep. My fear, we looked into, we tried to research see other medical providers at detention centers, and we finally got on a National Jail Association website and we found a list of nine. And my fear was that, you know, you got a couple different choices in different parts of the region of the United States. So, you know, some of these on this national website, they might be based where they do California and Oregon, you know, and so they're not necessarily going to provide that here.
Yeah, and like I said, this the medical situations in our jails now, Larry, it's just out of control because of the, and we all aware of this, you know, the heroin, the meth problems that we're having, especially the heroin. And after, you know, with Southern Health Partners, they've never, is what they tell me, this county, you know, all counties are dealing with this, but Madison County is really one of the hardest hit areas with heroin. I mean, it seems like everybody that comes through our doors over here, and I'm talking about pregnant, we have two women at the hospital right now pregnant with heroin issues. One has lost a child, so we're at the hospital with her, the other in the UK that we're sitting with for probably two or three days till she has her baby, because the child is high risk that we're over there now with that female inmate. And it's because of heroin. But it's our population, and we all know right now how we've grown with from, you know, the 150 to 200 to 300, now we're standing in the 360s with inmates, and we're 170 bed facility. So our population has grown and our medical needs have grown with it because of the drug issues. And for Southern Health Partners to stay on top of it, that they need to add another RPN or LPN or whatever it was, nurse practitioner, to help keep it all together. And for us as a whole here, you know, we have to have it covered, gotta have it. What we're dealing with today is just crazy not to have medicals in our jail. It's a high dollar expense.
How are they doing, Doug? I mean, they doing a good job?
Well, Southern Health Partners are doing a good job. I'm happy with them. They've just, our population has grown so much that they have to have more help. Just like I have to have more help when our population grows. You know, of officers. So, yeah, they're doing a good job, Larry, some of the health departments are.
Well, Doug, you in contact with other jailers throughout the state, and do you hear any news that anybody else is offering services that are better than what we're getting, or are you comparable, or?
Majority, and I don't know the exact number, but majority of jailers have Advanced Correctional Healthcare or Southern Health Partners. I've not seen another company out there until you got on the website, the national website or something, and we can't even get them calls back or emails back, you know, with some information. And two or three of them, we couldn't even get a hold of.
Yeah.
At Charles next association meeting, that'd probably be a good topic to talk on with all the jailers there.
Well, it's coming up in June the 6th through the 9th, and I'm not sure what our agenda is yet. I'll get that, but I'm not sure what it is yet.
It'd be a good idea to maybe touch base with someone, see if they'll have someone there.
Well, yeah.
You always learn stuff.
We always learn things at our associations and trainings, always something new, but Advanced Correctional Healthcare and Southern Health Partners are always there, because there's new jailers coming in and things like that, and they want to get their business also, but they're always at our
association. Have you compared any figures with the Advance?
We had Advance.
Yeah.
Okay.
We've had Advance first of all. When I decided to go this route with our courts, we got Advanced Correctional Healthcare. Then we needed more.
So you think Southern Health provides better care than Advance?
I think we do, and then we've all read the contract that we have that we have now with Southern Health Partners, and again, where our population has grown, you know, they have to have more help, so everybody needs a little more money and this kind of thing.
Well, the medicines, it just gets higher and higher and higher.
Well, the medications do, and also what people realize also is that it doesn't cover everything, because if we have to take an inmate to the hospital, then we have to pay for that ourselves, and we're allowed to pay for that out of commissary. Which we may pay that $1,000 tomorrow for an inmate that we took to the hospital. You know, 'cause we'll have to pay for the two girls that are in the hospital now. But with Medicare and that kind of stuff, we have to pay $1,000 is what our part will be when we have to. If it's a $5,000 bill, we'll pay $1,000 of that. That's every time. And we're allowed to pay that out of the commissary. So that's probably, I don't know the number on that, it could be $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 a year more that we're paying out of concert for that medical, with that to go to the hospital. And, you know, the nurses can only do so much inside of a jail that they have to go to the hospital.
And then you got to have somebody there with them.
And that's where we come in play, because we took the female to Lexington yesterday. Well, we've had somebody there the whole time with her. It's 24/7. Yeah. And the judges work well with us as trying to you know, get them on bond or whatever, but that's still our expense. We still have to pay that whether we're there or not, because we initially took them there. But you're right, Larry. It's somebody has to stay with and has to call people into work, and it's a lot going on anymore. A lot going on.
Oh, yeah. But Doug, you work with these providers, and you know best, you know, which ones to work are working the best with you and the most efficient and most economical. And you know, I take your advice on what you think we need to do on the situation.
Well, you know, I haven't got back, the other companies haven't got back with us. I just don't think we need to deal with Advanced Correctional Healthcare. I think, in my opinion, you know, I think the Southern Health Partners is the best route to go, Southern Health Partners. But again, the other ones haven't got back with me, and we contacted them last week.
What kind of decision do we need to make?
You all would just make a decision. I need a motion and a second and allow me to go into an agreement with Southern Health Partners, because it's a contract.
Well, I don't know. That's so much with it. I'm just hoping maybe between now and the end of June, somebody's going to come forward riding the wild.
Which I think what I would like to do, whether y'all give me permission or not, what I think I'd like to do is let's go ahead and pay them that monthly charge, just amend the original contract we have right now with the new amounts, still let it expire in September, and then they would give us some time to investigate, maybe seeing if there are other providers, and then if there is not, then we just renew our contract with them again in September, and then if there is, then we have some time to maybe
Well, that'd give us a little more time, and then they would probably feel comfortable too.
I don't look for them to come in and say, well, we're going to cut that a little bit for you.
No.
I don't look for that.
I don't see that.
We all know what the answer is, but how to pay for it.
Which I said originally when they, we obviously Doug and I were in a meeting with them, you know, I thought it would be 70,000. So I was actually pleased with them coming in at 50, was it 54 or something, 52 or something?
It ended up being $50,740.
$740, okay. So anyway, I would need a motion second to go into the approval. I would ask the court's permission.
So moved.
For approval to sign a contract with Southern Ed Partners. No more discussion. Call the roll.
Mr. Combs?
Yes.
Mr. Berger?
Yes.
Mr. Tudor?
Yes.
Mr. Bucket?
Yes.
Just a.
Yes. Now on to a positive note. We got our own online road salt bids, and we were very, very pleased with the cost. Last year, I think they were like $80.10, $85.90. Is that what it was? $85.90. Yeah. This year we actually got it for $66.81. So I would like to court's permission for me to go into an agreement with, I think it's Detroit. Is it Detroit?
Same as we had last year.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's Detroit Salt Company.
No problem with deliveries.
Is there a limited amount on that, Judge? Or
as much as we need? You got to tell them how much you want that price, don't you?
But
the tonnage we used prior year. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
This reverse bidding is a good thing.
It is. It is. It's a reverse option. Yep. Detroit Salt Company. That is it.
Scott, how many ton will we need to fill our barns back?
No. They're pretty full.
They're full, yeah. Each one of we roughly figure about 3,000 tons is what fills each bin up with. It fills both bins. I think one bin's a little bigger than the other one. The road north's bin's a little bigger than the other one, but however you want to do the math, 1,200, 1,800. Yeah.
Judge, I move we accept the bid of $66.81 for the salt.
Second.
If there's no more discussion, call the roll, please.
Mr. Berger?
Yes.
Mr. Tudor?
Yes.
Mr. Bakken?
Yes.
Mr. Combs?
Yes.
Just to.
Yes. Next on the agenda is a resolution 1604, which is a state road maintenance agreement. This is our agreement, the same as last year. Same amounts, $5,250 per mile. The state pays us for 142.85 miles of rural secondary roadways. It's the same agreement as we've had in the past. So I need a motion and a second for resolution 1604, state road maintenance agreement.
So moved.
Second.
If there's no more discussion, call roll.
Mr. Tudor?
Yes.
Mr. Bucket?
Yes.
Mr. Combs?
Yes.
Mr. Berger?
Yes.
Just Taylor?
Yes. Next is we got some hires. Let's see, our first one is road department. Scott, you'd like to come up and present to the court your recommendation.
Madison County Road Department, we advertised and had several applicants for truck driver general labor. Three panel review board interviewed all those people, and we would like to make the recommendation to hire Mr. Delbert Isaacs. He is currently employed with Burton Excavating, has been there several years, and has several more years prior experience in the construction business. He does hold a Class A CDL driver's license. He also has experience with dump trucks, backhoes, track hoes, and loader experience. And one of the main things Mr. Isaacs kind of hit home with all of us is he's working out of town now, and I really feel he wants to be part of the community, part of the government. He don't want to drive to Lexington anymore. He likes our benefits. We're being able to offer these people an advantage to stay home and get better quality people. I think that's important, and that's done for you all. So I would like to recommend Mr. Isaacs as a hire for truck driver.
Scott, I'd just like to say that I think you're hiring some qualified people. I talked to one of my neighbors just yesterday. Some of the road crew had been out and removed a tree from the side of his road that he'd asked to be removed. It was getting ready to fall down, and he which is kind of a preventive measure. He was tickled to death with the employees that came out and the way that they worked and how they worked with him to move it over into the back pond that he had out of the way. And so I think you guys are really doing a great job there. And if you recommend this gentleman, I move that we hire him.
All right, I have a motion. Do I have a second?
What's his start salary?
Starting pay is on standard of $13 per hour.
Thank you.
I'll say.
Any other discussion? Call the roll, please.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barton?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Judge Tate?
Yes. Scott Tussey, you got a hire in the animal control officer.
Good morning, everyone. The interview review board of myself and Colleen Chaney would, at this point, like to make the recommendation of hiring Jared Turner to be our new animal control officer. Jared is present here. There he is right there. So he's present here for the fiscal court. Jared is currently a graduate student with past volunteer experience with the Madison County Humane Society. He as well has had some construction experience as well as being an electrical assistant. I would recommend that we hire Jared in at $9.50 an hour for the animal control position.
So moved.
Second.
If there's no more discussion, call the roll, please.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barton?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Judge Tate?
And thanks. Now on the solid waste hire?
Yes.
You want to do it now? Mm-hmm.
Yep. Go ahead.
The interview review board of Robert Murphy, Scott Shepherd, Shannon Gordon, and myself would like to recommend the hiring of David Marshall for the position of solid waste truck driver laborer. David is formerly employed by the United States Federal Corrections Departments, where he served as an education specialist before he retired from there. He was also a United States Air Force reservist and has a bachelor's degree. He has most recently acquired his CDLB and has been doing some volunteer work driving school buses for his church. He was previously located in Phoenix, Arizona, and has, over the last few years, relocated back here to Madison County. I recommend that we start David at $13 an hour, and that is online with our classification system.
And he's the one going to be replacing somebody, right?
He's replacing Mr. England, who we terminated.
So moved.
So Scott, he will be with the large animal removal truck then?
No, he won't be assigned to the large animal removal truck. He will start him out with the loaner truck programs as well as the recycling as well as the large item pickup we do.
Okay. So,
but he would be, everybody serves as a backup for the dead animal truck.
All right. Second.
No more discussion. Call the roll.
Master Barton?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Judge Tate?
Yes. Thanks, Scott. Appreciate it. Next is new hire in the golf course. This is a seasonal employee. We had a seasonal employee that moved on, went somewhere, resigned with good standing. We appreciate him working for us as long as he has. But Clay and them's recommendation is to hire this Avery Collier. This is a $7.25 an hour position, and it is seasonal. So I need a motion and a second to approve the hire of Avery Collier at $7.25 an hour at the golf course.
So moved.
Second.
There's no more discussion. Call the roll, please.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barton?
Yes.
Judge Tate?
Yes. At this time, we have a personnel issue that we need to go into executive session on. So I need a motion and a second to go into executive session.
So moved.
Second.
Call the roll. Sorry.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Barton?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Judge Tate?
Yes.
Okay. I've been productive.
We were back out of story,
Rip.
Tom made the most.
Don't think it's
right. And Tom second to come out of the executive session.
All right.
And call the roll, please.
Master Combs?
Here.
Master Barton?
Here.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bakken?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. At this time, I need a motion and a second for the termination of Mr. Lee Evans in the road department.
Mm-hmm. I make that motion.
Second.
Is there any more discussion? call the roll, please.
Master Barker?
Yes.
Master Tutter?
Yes.
Master Bucking?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. At this time, next is the judge's report. I wanted to just make a few announcements of upcoming events around in the county. Remember, everybody, that Madison County Courthouse will be closed, and all the other offices too, the annex, finance, will be closed on Monday, May the 30th, which is this coming Monday, in observation of Memorial Day. We will reopen on Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock, May the 31st. Memorial Day services that are coming up, for anybody that has not heard, Brea Cemetery will hold a 2 p.m. Sunday service on May the 29th. Battle of Richmond will be held at the 2:30 on Sunday at the Richmond Cemetery on May the 29th. And then there'll also be another service at the Richmond Cemetery on Monday at 10 a.m., which will be May the 30th. And then Madison County Memorial Gardens is holding a service at 1 p.m. on Monday, May the 30th. There'll be a ribbon cutting for the opening of our newly renovated Madison County Emergency Operations Center from 10 until 11 a.m. on Friday, June the 10th. That will be at our facility on South Keeneland Drive. And RSVPs are requested by June 3rd. And that is open for anybody in the community that would like to come and see the new EOC. It is definitely something to be proud of. It's a very nice facility, and you all will get a tour of the facility as well. Brea Community School, they graduate, will be this Friday, May the 27th at 7 p.m. at the Seabury Center there at Brea College campus. And again, that's Brea Community's graduation for their seniors this year that are graduating will be Friday, May the 27th at 7 p.m. And then also remember to check out our channel 46, Madison County's Facebook page for most for the most up-to-date information. And also we'll be putting advertisements out for a new HR person in Madison County Fiscal Corps. So want to make sure I announce that. That's all I have. Next is comments from department heads. Miss Wendy's coming to tell us about 911 today.
Hello.
Appreciate you being here.
Thank you for having us. I guess the biggest thing for us over the past several months is planning our move to our new facility, and we're located in the new EOC, and we do have a state-of-the-art facility. Very, very proud of it. It was the move. We anticipated it to be worse than what it was, but it really went smoothly, and I have to say, with a lot of the help from all of our vendors, months and months of weekly vendor calls on every Thursday, Madison County IT, Chris and Ron, always on those calls, helping coordinate that move. They've done an excellent job. We had new Symphony consoles for the radio, so that was already in place, and then we done half of the move at the first part of the week, tested that equipment, and then moved the dispatchers over the second part of the week. So all of our services were uninterrupted, so the citizens didn't lose anything at all.
Great.
And so it was really great. It's a beautiful facility. It's really meant to be a 911 center. The staff is very proud. I'm very proud. A lot of help with the EMA CSEP staff as we've moved in have been wonderful. Any complaints or anything that we find in the building, little things, they get taken care of right away. So the move went great, and we're, like I say, we're very excited to be there. One of our big hot topics, of course, has been staffing. Full staff, we have 22 dispatchers, 2 admin, and 1 part-time today. We are at 20 dispatchers, 2 admin, and 1 part-time. We had a very successful pool of applicants. We have 7 in training right now. We have 2 that, 2 of those 7 will go in July to the 5-week training academy, which is sometimes a deterrence once people, that's why we're still down the 2 when it come down to it. Leaving your family and going and living in a dorm on campus for 5 weeks and only going home on weekends and in the afternoons a little while kind of deters people. And so we're moving up on staff. All of our training officers are working very hard, doing their job, still working the long hours and training the new recruits. And they get to see what it's like, you know, when you're short-staffed and you're very busy in what they do. Being short-staffed actually was an eye-opener to myself and my assistant director because we actually worked in the radio room for the first time in a few years. Took a little bit getting into the groove of things, but we've been okay. So we actually worked radio channels and done the phones, and it was wonderful to see my staff in action, and I think the county should be very proud of the people that we have. They do an outstanding, excellent job, and I know I was very proud of what they done. And other than that, we're like everybody else. I mean, we worked really hard on our budget. The 911 board came together and we gave a sound budget again for the citizens. The operational support for all three governments stayed at $148,000, and then our capital loan project pays off from our CAD upgrade that we done a few years ago. It actually pays off in August of 2016. We're very excited about that. And also, that gives us a small break, but in the 2017-2018 budget, I'll be coming back to you because we'll need to do either another upgrade or a new CAD system. So we're already working on the budget for the 2017-2018 so we can get some good numbers. And we're reviewing our SOPs and administrative code. And at 911, we're actually doing an accreditation process. It's through the Kentucky Chiefs Associations. Before this came out about a year and a half ago, there were not any of the actual 911 centers that were accredited. It was always the police departments that were accredited. So we've joined in on that. There's a handful ahead of us that have gotten done, but with moving, we've had to change a lot of our policies and different things to the new location. So we'll be updating those, and we're revamping our training program. So once we get that handful of things done in the next few months, they'll come in and do a site assessment, and we'll go from there with our accreditation to meet at least the minimum standards. And in a lot of areas, we exceed. So I was very proud going through that also, how far we already were, just a matter of putting it in writing. So. And as always, we're busy, and I wish I had all the call counts, but where we've moved and everything's still boxed, I just brought yesterday because it was on the printer this morning. It prints out daily. Just to give you an idea of what the staff does, yesterday we had 210 911 calls, and we had 353 administrative calls in a 24-hour period. We had 563 calls for service, not counting our radio traffic and other duties that we perform with paperwork and those kind of things.
Is that midnight to midnight?
Midnight to midnight. Yeah.
How many does it take to full staff?
Usually, on average, we like to have 4 to 5 on first shift. Second shift, our 2 to 10 period, and it's a little bit busier. Right now, we work 4 to 5 on that shift, but optimally staffed, we'll be closer to 6 to 7 during the peak times. And then after hours, currently we have 3, sometimes 4, and we'll keep that at a 4 at full staff, hopefully. And then every now and then, like especially when Eastern's back on those Thursday, Fridays, and Saturdays, pick it up a little bit to like 2 a.m.
All the days busier.
It fluctuates. Mondays and Thursdays are busy days for us. You would think Fridays and Saturdays would be your busiest. Saturday picks up in the evening, so some of the busier days, it's not like the whole day fluctuates. We just have busier hours. Each shift has their busy day fluctuates. Like for first, Mondays and Thursdays are big days, and for second, your Fridays and Saturdays, and the same for third.
Well, I want to commend you and your staff for the job you do. It looks like that you all do look ahead. And you know, there's a lot of figures to be put together
to
know. And you know, you got to be there firsthand and other things.
Yeah.
But I commend you.
Thank you. Thank you. They're a wonderful group of people.
It's been a long, long time since I had someone to complain to me.
Good. Good. We work hard too.
I know you're busy. What you say about Monday's true, because I made a call last night about 2:30 for a citizen, and the very first thing that happened, it was on hold for about 2 minutes. I'm like, man, it's Monday night. What's going on? So
yeah,
there
is.
You go.
Yeah,
it's the truth. It got resolved, but
yeah.
I mean,
it takes
surprised.
A little while. I mean, the phones, a lot of times we have more phone calls coming in than we have people. I mean, even if we had 10 people, it wouldn't matter, because if you have a wreck or something going on the interstate, you're probably going to get 20 phone calls. So it's like, you know, as soon as you're done handling the calls you did get, then you have to go back and call everybody that called to make sure that's what they were actually calling about. So it's like spikes, you know, of time. It's not always constant. That doesn't happen every day, but when it does, and it hits, it hits.
Wendy, do you ever have trouble with 911 calls coming in from a different area that may not be in the Richmond or Massachusetts area?
We do. A lot of it depends on your geographical area. A lot of it is where your cell towers are, and we find a lot of it is at county line cell towers, like the cell towers closer. It's between us and Lexington, depending on where you are on the interstate. A lot of times we get calls for Fayette County, and I mean, they'll be at 104.
Reroute them.
And we'll reroute that to Fayette County.
And Paint Lick's always been a
Paint lot. Lick's a big yeah. area, yes. Yeah. And if anybody's seen the news article, Pusey Ridge has some areas too in there. And sometimes it will depend on your cell phone carrier too, if it's the AT&T tower. If it's.
I had it happen to me at my house in Bloomsburg Road. And I called, there was a car on fire on Bloomsburg Road right behind my house, and so I called 911 on my phone, and it connected me to Clark County.
And then they have to route you.
And then they
you're almost in Clark County. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And then they had to route. Then they had to route me.
It happens, and sometimes for unknown reasons. We had a call the other day that we got from Harlan County, and it was a landline phone. So that's an issue. As soon as we get those, we give those to Megan, in GIS, and she works with Entrado, and then within minutes, that was fixed. I mean, it's a lot of that. It's just the phone company has the wrong number or wrong area.
Do you have very many people that call just to see if it's working?
We do have people that call to see if it works.
I believe they will.
We have a lot of people that call, and you 911 was your emergency, and the first words are, "It's not an emergency, but I didn't know who to call." So we'll go ahead and help them, and then give them the non-emergency number for the next time. And sometimes they may have to hold while we answer the other 911s, but we take care of those. It's such a common number. Everybody doesn't know their local law enforcement numbers like they used to.
I remember, Wendy, when my son was little, he called 911. They explained 911 system at school to him, and we got home. He had to try it out. I think he was four or five. He called 911. They said, "What's the emergency?" He said, "I've got a broken leg." I said, "If you don't hang that phone up, you're going to have a broken leg."
Yeah, they do. And we do get a lot of kids that play on phones. If you have an old phone and it doesn't have service anymore, and you let them play the games and things on it, it can still call 911. Uh-huh. So a lot of times we may or may not get to speak to a parent, but usually you can tell that everything's okay because they're having a ball. But you have to stay on the line long enough to see if anything else is going on. So we do speak to a lot of parents.
Appreciate what y'all do.
Seems like you've had it out.
We do. We have it all.
Thank you, Wendy. I appreciate you giving us an update today. It's great. Comments from Ashers? Larry?
Start me again.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah. What about next year? They did get the lights up on Scaffold Cane, so I look for them to start any day now.
Good.
And that road's in bad shape. I know it was a lot of money, and I had some people criticize me over that. Said, "Well, here you spend that kind of money on Scaffold Cane, and it doesn't help Brea," but it does help Brea. We have a lot of people in Scaffold Cane, Rockcastle County, that come that way to work. And, I wish it wasn't as much as that it's going to cost, but it's money coming through the state anyway.
Right.
So, you can't please everybody. I just try to please myself.
Yeah.
Other than that, I'm just glad to be here, Judge.
Glad you're here. Ross?
His work there is not in my district, but it's still in Madison County. That's right. What it's all about. I want to commend the judge on his state of the county address. He's doing a great job.
Thank you very much.
As I told him, I said, you seem a little more comfortable and confident about what you're saying because you've been in office enough, but more familiar with the issues at hand. Done a good job. And I want to thank all the department heads, as well as the judge and the deputy judge, executive, for the work that they've done on the budget. We get to sit here and let them do the work figuring out what the figures are going to be, and then we get to pick it if we want to. It's a lot of time involved, and I appreciate all of you that are department heads and what you do, and the understanding that, we're trying to save every penny we can, and some of your budgets may be a little less. That's just part of the job.
Yep.
That's all we got, Judge.
Thank you, Bud. John?
First off, I want to congratulate all the graduates that graduated from high school and colleges and universities this past week. That was a big step in their life, and they're going to move on to jobs and new positions, and I just want to congratulate all those young ladies and young men. I want to thank Glenna this morning for helping put a budget together that I think we can work with. And she is so involved with all the departments, working and trying to pinch every penny that she can. And Glenna does a great job over there behind the scenes. She don't really get recognized sometimes, but I appreciate you. And also, Memorial Day is coming up this Monday, as you may point out. Just take time to really be thankful and appreciate the meaning of Memorial Day, and just reflect back on the veterans that have paid the ultimate sacrifice that we can be here and have the privilege that we do today, and give thanks to them, and be with your family and enjoy that time together. And that's all I got to do.
Thanks, Clay. Tom?
I had a busy 2 weeks, Judge. I went down last week, I was fortunate enough to have a little time to run down to the road department when they were doing the training down there on their new supply system, and see them inventorying and getting parts put in, and actually do some orders while I were there. And I was pretty impressed with that. I think that's going to help us save some money. It'll definitely help us with our parts control and having what we need, when we need it, and trying to get rid of surplus. You don't need everything in the world, as much as I like to hang on to every bulb and flashlight and you name it, but we don't need everything in the world. And as a county government, it'll certainly help us thin that out. I referenced a little bit about a call I made last night. It was from a citizen who lives down at Will Green. And of course, Will Green is open now, and there's not a fee to launch your boats, but it's also summertime, and traffic's going to pick up down at Will Green at the nighttime. I asked the people that go down there and fish down there to please just be considerate of the folks that live down there on Will Green, because you don't really think about it when you're standing down there in that parking lot, and especially if you're hollering back and forth to your buddies, but there's a house that's right on top of that hill there, and it echoes right up out of that parking lot, and if you got your radio on maybe a little too loud, and all of that affects the people that have to get up at 5 a.m. to go to work the next morning. So just please be considerate of those folks down at the lake. Also, 2 weeks ago, I got to go down to Somerset with Mary Renfro from the school board and attend a conference down at Somerset for Hometown Against Heroin. You know, we've talked about this all through this meeting of things that elude and affect the problem that drugs cause. You know, it's affecting our jail. It's affecting our budgets. It affects the sheriff's department. You know, it affects the jail and them moving their personnel. It's just a big, huge expense on there. And, you know, we have to find a solution to it. You know, I guess it's a double-edged sword. It's a good thing that Madison County is where it's at, because we have 75 running smack dab through our county. Sometimes that's a bad thing simply because we are easy access from Detroit. We're easy access from Atlanta, and that's where a lot of our drugs are coming from. I saw a lady down there who, while we were there, who had a son who had been in the Marine Corps, and he had been injured, and he was being treated by the VA, and they had him on painkillers, and he got addicted to painkillers. Well, after some point in time, the VA wouldn't treat him anymore, and he was discharged. He still had his addiction to painkillers, and you can buy painkillers. They sell them for anywhere from $50 to $100 for a single pill on the street. And that led on and on to on till he finally stumbled into a need to relieve his pain. He got on heroin. I found out at the conference down there that heroin, the way it is mixed now with fentanyl, is so potent. Now listen, you guys got, it's hard for me to believe this because I don't understand the addiction thing. They said that it's so potent that one time, use it one time, and you're addicted to it. I mean, think about that. Think about your kids. I mean, people make mistakes every single day. One time and your life is ruined. And so, you know, there was just a lot of discussions and things that we may be able to do here in Madison County to help combat that. And, you know, I'm working on all of those things. And then there's a lot of hope that goes along with that. I just want to share this. I've talked to the judge and some of the other magistrates about it. The sheriff a couple weeks ago had a drug rep come into him, and he gave him a brochure about a drug that's called Vivitrol. And what Vivitrol is, it's an opium blocker. And so what it does is, it's non-addicting, but it simply is a shot that a person who wants help can take, and it blocks their desire for a drug for 28 days. The circuit court judge, a guy named David Tappan, 28th Circuit Court in Laurel County, spoke to us, and he just told of the success that his court is having down there with people that have just been addicted for years who are now using this this medicine that's helping them. It's helping them break that habit. It's giving them some hope, and that's what it's all about. There's got to be some hope to it somewhere. So, you know, we're going to try to work with the health department here. You know, I've already talked to the jail about it, and you know, I'm going to hit the county attorney pretty soon. And they've had enough success in the Laurel County that they are actually using this, the Vivitrol, along with rehab programs to avert jail time. So it's helping with the jail. There's a lot of things that this can be positive for, and especially with helping somebody get their life straight. So anything else, if anybody needs me, they can reach me at 200-9765. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you. Mike, you got anything?
No, sir.
You don't have anything?
Matthew.
Or Matthew, I'm sorry. Appreciate you filling in for.
Glad to be here.
Mark.
We'll run down the election. Madison County had 20.9% turnout. State large was about 17, which is normally how we go. We usually turn out a little better than the state. Everything went smooth. I didn't expect a 20% turnout and didn't feel like a 20% turnout because we didn't have as many calls. But we had the normal, primary calls of people registered one way or the other and thought they were registered the other way, which in a primary, you can't just decide the day of the election how you will vote. And we had a lot of folks that were registered as other. And just to send this out there, buddy, when you go change anything at driver's license, your address or anything, you have to completely fill out that card. We can't, when we get a blank card in, we have to mark that person as other by statute. It would seem like we would just leave them if they were Democrat. When they signed the card last time, they were Democrat this time. But if they don't fill that card out, we have to mark them as other. So then they don't know that until they show up on election day and they can't vote on either race. So fill those cards out. It's, you're signing an affidavit, it's important. Please fill it out completely. We had some problems with signage at polling locations. Anything outside 100 feet from the door the voter enters, that's all we control as election officials. Everything outside that is either up to the state on the right of way, the county schools where we're voting, whoever owns the property. If they want to remove it, they can. Example was at Easter, 7:30 in the morning, everything was gone. Easter doesn't allow that kind of thing without prior approval. So I know we had a lot of people complaining that the signs were there, but there's nothing we can do about it, anything outside 100 feet from the door the voter enters, not the front of the school, not the property line. Nothing on June 10th, we will be moving from our office in Berea City Hall into the municipal building. I call it the old post office, but it's the municipal building, yeah, on the other side of the service station from City Hall. And that will be a permanent move. We hope to be only be closed half a day. Should have everything lined out and ready to plug up and go when we move in. But that'll be our new location. We'll be entered through the back door. The office has been remodeled. They've built a little area to enter, keep the kind of the weather out. Wheelchair ramps there. They're ready to go for it.
And this will be June 10th?
June 10th.
June 10th.
On Friday.
That's where we meet over there.
Yeah, that's where where the chamber, Bridge Chamber is. Or Bridge Chambers are for their meeting. And I'd like to thank also the road department for help on election day. We couldn't do it without them. And again, thank the court and the judge for allowing us to move our machines from the basement of the fire department out here. It cut an hour off our delivery time, which doesn't sound like a lot, but if you hit those schools at in the afternoon pickup time, we can't start any earlier than when the buses clear out, and we got to quit, get done before the parents show up, pick those kids up. If you show up during that time, you're shut down for about 45 minutes. You can't get in and out. So that hour helps us a lot. And it also helps if we ever have trouble with a truck or something. The further ahead we are, the more time we'll have to recover if we have something go wrong, because we've only got one day to get that stuff in the schools. If 6 o'clock Tuesday morning comes and we don't have the stuff there, we've got a big problem. So I'd like to thank y'all for letting us do that. It's been great.
Election started at 6 yesterday.
No, 6 to 6. I hope it wasn't mine.
Hey, Rick, I just want to say that I got 25 people or prisoners that are being baptized tonight.
Oh, yeah?
25.
Congratulations.
Yeah, right. Kenny Davis is coming down, and 25.
Good. Yeah. Yeah. Great. Kenny, you do? You good?
I'm good.
All right, thanks. Appreciate your words and comments. Comments from the audience. Anybody in the audience need to say something?
I put a note on all your all's desk, and I just want to take a minute. But my name is Spencer Guiley. Some of y'all know me, and I live in the 4th District. I used to live over in Rogers, but I moved. And I'm part of a project that is happening in every magisterial district, and so I want y'all to know about it. Madison County is home to over 344 cemeteries. 76 of them are considered more major. They have over 25 burials, but most of them are the resting place of our veterans. Coming up on Memorial Day, we think about that more, I guess. But last year, with the help of Philip Seifert, your all's historical property director, we went into many of these rural cemeteries that are forgotten and put out flags on these veterans' graves, because the larger cemeteries are remembered. Veterans groups carry those, but you know, we want to remember everybody, because they are the reason we're here today, as Mr. Tudor said. This year, last year we put out around 300 flags. This year, we've already put out over 550, from Big Hill to Poosie to Red Lick, Newby, Clays Ferry, Doylesville. Every magisterial district has been visited already, and we're not done. We still have somewhere around 200 flags that have been bought all by private donations. No public funds have been put into this project. These veterans that are buried in Madison County cemeteries, you know, they are, as Philip says, are our national treasures, and they are the reason we're here today. So I just wanted you all to be aware of what was going on in your district. And if you have any, you know, concerns about any of that, or if you know of some place that we might not be able to visit, feel free to let me know. Be glad to go there. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Spencer, we appreciate you doing that. Yeah, it's great.
It's an honor to do it.
Anybody else in the audience? This time, I need a motion and a second to pay the claims and approve the transfers.
So moved.
Second.
If there's no discussion, call the roll.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Master Bucket?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Berger?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes. Next court date is Thursday, June the 2nd. This is our special call meeting where we'll be discussing the jail task force decisions. Again, that's Thursday, June the 2nd, and it'll be at our regular time, 9:30. And then our next regular court meeting will be on Tuesday, June 14th, 2016, here in Richmond. So we'll have a three-week period between the courts. We've got a five-week month. So I want to thank everybody for being here today. Appreciate your patience. Good meeting. I need a motion and a second to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Call the roll, please.
Master Bucket?
Yes.
Master Combs?
Yes.
Master Berger?
Yes.
Master Tudor?
Yes.
Judge Taylor?
Yes.